Luke chapter 1 and then Acts chapter 3. Luke chapter 1. We start this story. Zacharias is a priest, and it was his turn to offer incense before the Lord. And this is where the story picks up. I think let's go back to the 11th verse for clarity. Clay, thank you. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him. That's amazing right there. Standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And where the altar of incense was situated, you had an outer court of the tabernacle. And then the inner court would have the candlestick to the left and the table of showbread to the right. And in the middle in the front, just prior to the final curtain, would be the altar of incense, where sweet fragrance was being elevated to the Lord as a symbol of prayer, intercession, and talking with the Lord. And it was, again, Zechariah's turn to offer incense, which was a high honor, a very high honor. And while he was doing the normal, the angel appeared. And while you're doing the normal, God reveals himself. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, "Do not be afraid." Easy for him to say. "Zacharias, don't be afraid, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will also go before him in the spirit of power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." And Zacharias said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is well advanced in years." And the angel answered and said to him, in quotation, with an attitude, "I am Gabriel, and these are my credentials. I stand in the presence of God, and was sent to speak to you and to bring you these glad tidings. But since you had 2 cents to add to it, behold, you will be mute. You cannot talk and will not talk and not be able to speak until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their own time and not in yours." What a nice engagement with an angel. It always captures my heart when he makes the statement, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God." Now, that's a big deal. I stand in the presence of God. In other words, his angels and little children's angels do always behold the face of God. And so now that tells you that little children in the household of faith have an angel assigned to them. And they stand in the presence of God and see the face of God. Be careful how you treat the kids. So the scripture says, bring them up in the reverence of God, that their totality of their purpose is to reverence God. And so the scripture says, train a child in the way that he should go. Another rendition could be in the way that he is bent, the way that he has been bent by God. And bent means simply, he likes to work on tools with tools, and he's not much on the piano. But your granddaddy played the piano. Yeah, well, he'd rather have a wrench. So recognize how God is bending him and help him with the wrenches. I was at a farmer's house one day and sitting down talking to him. This is way back when I was working for the corporation. I was sitting down talking to the farmer, and their house was situated in such a way that I could see into their kitchen, and their family room had a wall, and I could see them, and I could look into their kitchen. They couldn't look into the kitchen. I could look into the kitchen and see them. And they had this little fella. He was kind of a, he looked to be maybe about 4 years old, maybe. And he come in there with a little toolbox. And he started taking the doors off the cabinets. Now, that wouldn't roll too much in Mama's house. But anyway, I kind of interrupted him. I said, your son is taking the doors off the cabinets. He said, oh, yeah, he'll put them back. Just like that. No, oh, and you could see all the little scratches where the screwdriver had missed its mark. And I learned something there because he didn't mind training him the way he was bent. And he wanted to work with the screwdriver, and he didn't have precision and accuracy, but he was growing up into what he was bent towards. And they had no problem with the scratches. I had problems with the scratches. Parents didn't have problems with the scratches. So I'm not going to have problem with your scratches if you don't have no problem with mine. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so, I am Gabriel and I stand in the presence of God. I absorb the energy from God, and that's why I'm bringing you this message with power. I'm bringing you this message not because I decided to bring it, but because I was standing before the presence of God. Now I am come. I've been sent to give you this good news and glad tidings that Elizabeth, who was called barren, is now going to have a child, and he's going to be great in the sight of the Lord, and you're going to name him John, and he's going to be a forerunner before the Messiah and all of that. And then he's going to come up with a question like, now, how in the world this is going to happen, because I'm old, and my wife is, you know, she's getting along too in her years. And then he said, man, say that with me, man. No, you didn't say it right. Because you know you can say that with another different attitude, that like when somebody's saying something that you know they ought to know better, man. How about, what? Y'all said it real nice. I mean, y'all saying it real nice. You sophisticated today. Just let one of your kids say something that don't make no sense. What? And then you may add, boy, didn't I tell you? Well, anyway, Gabriel, you can see his little, like, you know, he's coming direct at him. He said, I'm Gabriel. You don't listen. Now, you know, back in the day, I'm not talking about now because you don't do this anymore. Back in the day, you would say things like, you don't know who you're talking to. Now, I know you don't do that now. Do you? I'm Gabriel. I got this information from God, and you best know that you're not going to be able to say a word until it comes to pass because you didn't believe what I said. Now, I know if you go further in the story, Gabriel's dispatched to a little town in Bethlehem and to a virgin girl named Mary and gives her the same type of tidings 6 months later after John or Elizabeth was pregnant. And he said that, you know, the seed that's in you is going to be called the Son of God. And so she responds and says, how can these things be? I've never known a man. But she didn't say it in doubt. She just wanted to know how we're going to work this out. We can do it now. How are we going to do it? How this is going to work? He said the Holy Spirit is going to, see, he explains it. Holy Spirit is going to come upon you and overshadow you. And that's how God's going to do this. And then she goes on to praise God and bless God. And, you know, that the Spirit of God has spoken. God is considered his handmaid and all of that. And she prophesies, rejoicing. Then she goes over to Elizabeth. She walks into Elizabeth's house. John the Baptist, who's in Elizabeth's womb, starts leaping, jumping. You think about your baby kicking. How about one leaping? A little different, isn't it? But he got excited over one thing. John the Baptist in the womb got excited over one thing. He got excited because the presence of God entered the room. You better feel this. Because Jesus was there while in Mary's womb, he was still God. And the prophet picked it up that God is here. And just as angels stand in the presence of God, John the Baptist was in the presence of God. Did you notice the lineup of songs today that I had nothing to do with that began to talk about the presence of the Lord and I worship you and all of that? And I said, oh, Lord, you're setting this one up. Let's go to the beginning for a little bit. And we see that God created Adam perfect. And his wife he brought forth from his side. It was a beautiful event. And then Adam sinned. And when he sinned, he hid from God. And he heard God walking. He heard God walking in the garden. King James would say he heard the voice of God walking in the garden. It's still the presence of the Lord in the garden. And we know this to be true is because he's hiding himself from the presence of the Lord. How can you do it? It can't be done except the realization of his presence can be void to the onlooker if they don't see it or see him or know him. It's just like this. This is what the presence of God is like. Now you answer this. If it's 89 degrees tomorrow, full sunshine, and that's warm, isn't it? Yeah. Angels from Africa has come, you know? Yeah. 89 degrees in November, okay? And so now, all of a sudden, you go into a building, and the thermostat is 50 degrees. Stepping out of 89 into 50 degrees, you would say it's a little what? Cold. It's cold. Especially if you're sitting there, you're going to get a little cold because you left out. You're familiar with 89. The question is there, when the thermostat is on 50 and it's 89 outside, is there still heat in the building? Answer? It is heat in the building. Okay, all of a sudden that you can recognize the fact that you leave one spot and come to another spot and there's heat in the building. Now, let's turn around. Now it's 10 below zero with 35 miles an hour wind and you're standing out shaking and you walk into that same building at 50 degrees. Now you say it's warm in there. The temperature didn't change. That's your realization changed. So it is with the presence of the Lord. He can be present and he speak from heaven and some people hear thunder and the other people hear, this is my beloved son. Same presence, same word, same God. It's just the awakening. We call it revival. We call it the great awakening. We call that coming alive again. We call it being born again. And it all leads to the same thing, the presence of God. That God has not made it hard for men, so there's no presence specialist. It's the same route for everybody. When he says, I will never leave you or forsake you, it is not a concept. It is a realization. If you're in a moment of weakness and someone who is strong to handle your problem said, no, I'm going to be here with you. I'm going to hold your hand through this. I'm not going to forsake you. And you feel help coming on. That you're saying, God used him. In my weakness, God, he stood by my side. I had the measles, the mumps, and the tonsillitis at the same time. I was a sick little fellow one night. At 4 years old, it was like the enemy wanted to take me out, as if that could stop me from preaching today. God said, not so, but my mama never left my side. She kept cold towels on my head, and she would wipe me down with that green alcohol. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That's got that menthol in it. And, you know, I just didn't like that smell. But what am I going to say? I'm so sick. But mama wasn't there. And when it got so bad, I remember now at 4 years old, I was in my daddy's arm walking down Obese Hospital's hallways. He had on a black suit and a gold shirt. He had me in his arms. And then they wanted to give me some medicine, send me home. And he said, not today. Military came out. This is not going to happen. And so then they put me in a cold bath to break the water, to break my temperature. Then the measles popped out, which was what was really making me sick. But because daddy was by my side and mama was by my side, then the end of this matter turned to good. So when Jesus said, I'm with you and I will never leave you, Emmanuel means God present with us. If you walk outside, most of us would say it's daylight outside. But then those many of us can say God is outside. And God said, let there be light, and there was light before there was a sun. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And I'm not just trying to delve into the science component of light, but light without sun is presence. He just put his glory in a star, made it shine, and it's been shining for so many thousands of years, but it would never shine if God didn't place or deposit his glory in the sun to radiate the earth. That's why the book of the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, there's a glory of the sun, there's a glory of the moon, and there's a glory of the stars also. And each star, each sun, differs from one another in glory based on the measure of God's glory that it gives to the thing that he created. Did that make sense to you? So glory goes hand in hand with presence. Moses said, unless your presence goes with us, we're not going. They knew something about presence that could escape the natural mind in modern days, who may be confused by make-believe and whether or not Thor is really real. That, you know, cartoons that is not based in reality could sometimes frustrate the reality of God being God and a very present help in the time of trouble. Why does he say very present? Because he's always present, but when you're in need, he'll intensify that presence so that you'll realize this is God. And so the scripture says, if God be for you, who can be against you? And that his presence will go before you. That's what he promised Moses, because he was going into unknown territory. And God promised him, I will go with you. My presence will. And so Moses got so excited. He said, okay, if you're doing all that, let me see your face. He said, no, you can't see my face and live. Because of the intensity of his glory is in his face. So therefore, when you look at the word presence in the scripture, what you're going to see, defined first definition, is face. The face of God. Gabriel said, I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of God, in the face of God. Now, we know in Scripture that Moses talked to God face to face, as a man talks to a friend. So God can appear out of his glory, and he can appear in his glory. But Jesus declared the glory of God. You'll see that in the book of Hebrews, that he is the express image of his person and the brightness of his glory. Come to us here in the earth. So now let me catch you up. Gabriel has made an announcement to Zechariah that a prophet is being born. And that prophet is going to be a forerunner and declare the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you would follow with me to Acts chapter 3, I'm going to start at the first verse. I'm going to read a little bit, but that's okay. We're in church. We can read the Bible. Say amen. Yeah, I know sometimes we just get one scripture and you just, we're going to read in a little bit. And let's just start off in Acts. I'm going to try to get it along with you. Acts chapter 3. I want you to see something. And Peter and John went up together to the temple. They went to church at the hour of prayer. We're going to have that. And a certain man, not just a make-believe man, a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask benevolence, alms from those who entered the temple, who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, and he asked charity or alms from them, and fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, "Look at us." So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, don't have any money right now, don't have no credit card. But what I do have, I give you in the name of Jesus Christ." You know this story, I hope. "Then in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lift him up. Immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And I'm just going to submit to you right now, that's the presence of God manifested in his ankles and in his bones. That's the presence of God. And he said, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lift him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he... Now watch this. He leaping up stood, I would leap too, stood and walked and entered into the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. So how would that look like? Well, I'm walking here and then I'm jumping here and I'm praising God the whole time. I'm walking and then I'm leaping. I'm walking because, see, I couldn't walk. And somebody who's over there in the corner saying, why are they acting like that in church? That's why when Caroline was just leaping, I said, "Why must you be in my message?" But it teaches us some, the same Holy Spirit, he will authenticate his coming, his presence. Amen. And so if air was presence, then everyone should know God. But we would have no air without his presence. And yes, he reigns, R-A-I-N, on the farmer's field that doesn't know him as well as the farmer's field who does know him. And that same rain blesses both of them. He reigns on the just and the unjust, and he gives air to the just. The day will come and they will realize that the air they were breathing was God. So that no man will have an excuse. Because we can set it aside and just from a cerebral standpoint and talk about the molecular structure of oxygen and all those things, and we separate it from a mental standpoint, but really, in truth, the air we breathe is the Lord. I'm going somewhere, just stay with me. So he's leaping up and stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. Wouldn't you do the same? And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Now, did he have any problem walking and praising God? Well, he said, "Well, I want to be sensitive to other people, so I'm not going to praise God." And listen, he is worthy of all of our praise. Am I right? All right. Then they knew that it was he who sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Wow. 11th verse. Now, as the lame man who was healed held on to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the porch, which is called Solomon's, greatly amazed. So when Peter saw it, he responded to the people, "Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why look so intently at us as though by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk?" Amplified. It is by the presence of God that he's walking. The presence that your fathers knew about when they were trekking through the wilderness, and he was a cloud in the day and a column of fire at night. And they weren't reading the scripture, they were living by presence. And either the tabernacle that they built, it was called the tent of meeting and the tent of presence, the table of presence. That in the holy place beyond the veil was the very presence of God. Before they even have a tabernacle that he would commune with them in, he led them through the day and through the night, and they lived by presence, and presence was a norm for them. And it is the word of the Lord to you today, is that the presence of the Lord is to be a norm to you also. That it's not extraordinary, it's ordinary, it's regular. The presence of God, because God is with us. And he's not with us in concept, he's with us. Run up here real quick, Stacy. You can run, you're young enough. Come on up here, girl. Run, 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 run. Everyone say, run, Forrest. Now run, Stacy. Yeah, all right. Now she's ran, she's run, and she's got on black pants and got a little black in there. Is she cool? She cool. All right, now, am I in her presence? Yeah, you agree? Am I in your presence?
Yes.
Okay. Am I in your presence?
Yes, you are.
I am in your presence. You know some things.
Yes.
Now listen. Now close your eyes. Am I in your presence close to you?
No.
Keep your eyes closed. Am I with you?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. Now I could walk with you. Go ahead and walk a little bit. Just walk a little bit. I could walk with you. I could walk with you. And then you say, "Lord, I don't know where I'm going."
Lord, I don't know where I'm going.
Then you could walk with me then. And I lead and guide you into all truth. Because when the Spirit of God came, it was the presence of God that came. The presence of the Lord came. And then all of a sudden, there is not only just the presence of the Lord that fills this room. Me holding her hand is manifested presence. That's God making himself intently real to your life. And we sung songs back in the day, say, "He touched me." That was not just in concept. I was thinking about it. He touched my brain. No, he touched you. And all the joy that flooded my soul, something happened. And now I know he touched me and made me whole. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Give her a hand. So religion says just be intellectual with God. But you have to love him with all your heart, your mind, and your soul is what the command is. So therefore, he is a God that you can feel. He's a God that you can know. And who am I that she could declare that I was present with her? And God says, "I'll never leave you." And you get hung up whether or not he left you. Think about it. Just think about it. What is the Lord doing? And what is he saying? And what is the Lord is going to do among us? Did you ask that question? You did? Then let me find an answer for you. Go back to Acts chapter 3. Verse 13. "The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. He wanted to get him off, but you didn't want that. But you denied the Holy One speaking to Israel and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. Now, what are we going to do with Israel now? What are we going to do with Israel now? Because even in that land, that sovereign land that belongs to God, what are we going to do with Israel now? Are we going to pray for military might, or are we going to pray for presence? God has always delivered them by presence. Because we know by reading the Bible that military might will not deliver them ultimately. That it will be the presence of God that shows himself strong. So he tells us, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And so that's how I've been praying. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. So when you pray for the peace of Jerusalem, you're praying for the presence of God in Jerusalem. And whenever you experience peace in your heart, that is the presence of God in your heart. You say, well, where was God? He was there the whole time, but you got the revelation. You became alive. You cast all things that you've been holding on to, let them go, and then came the outpouring of God into your heart. And you think he came, but he was always there. There's nowhere he can come to, because he's everywhere. Am I right? I've heard people pray, say, Lord, go down into the hospital. I said, well, I wonder where he's coming from. When the scripture says he is a very present help in the time of need. And so therefore we change our prayers around and say, oh, Lord of presence. Say it right now. Oh, Lord of presence, even my God who is with me now, I adore you. Honor you, worship you, thank you, cleanse your servant. So you felt that. You felt that. Isn't it amazing you can hear a word from the Lord? Forget the man that's talking. Listen, a word from the Lord, and that word, it goes into your ear and it activates your soul because God is real. You cannot analyze him. He is just to be received. Amen? All right, a little bit more. But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you and kill the Prince of Life whom God raised from the dead. The foundation of our gospel is that the dead live. Come on now. The foundation of our gospel is the dead live. This past week, Sister Bev was escorted to glory according to the promise of God. And God did her right, and she left. Glory to God in the highest. Oh, Lord, let me die the death of a saint. Amen. And he killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead. So you killed him, but God raised him up, of which we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Yet now, brethren, pay attention here. I know that you did it in ignorance. You didn't know what you were doing. As did your rulers. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of his prophets, that Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. 19th verse. Repent, therefore. Be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that the time of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Pause. And when I was interceding to the Lord and following the demonstration that Lois gave, as he was filling my cup for you, he said, tell my people that the times of refreshing is at hand. Now, I can tell you some things that it doesn't mean. I'll spend more time on what it does mean. It means that by your sheer will and unction, you will overthrow a prayerless life. Because you will pray because you want to pray. You will pray because you urge the urgency to pray. You know what it means to eat. You eat because you want to eat. Not to check the box. Well, let me get up here and check the box, see if I'm going to eat today. Check, check. No. I made a mistake. What did I do? I made a mistake. I woke up in the morning and I turned the TV on. Now you say, that's no problem. I do that. Like the first thing, you may have to see the news, or the first thing you need to see a score or something like that. But I made that mistake. And so I flipped on because I want to see maybe what was happening in the news when the Jerusalem thing was first happening. Well, now I made a mistake. I'm confessing before God and before man that I did a horrible thing. And so behind that, the spirit of presence convicted my heart. And it said, my first order of business is to talk to him. Y'all did not hear that. Maybe you want to clog your ears. Maybe you don't really want to hear this. Maybe you say, I got something to do, somebody to call. Maybe you do phone first thing in the morning. Maybe you go check social media first thing in the morning. But the order of the day is to talk to him first thing in the morning, since in him you live, move, and have your being. And you'll know that the day of refreshing is come because you're not praying because I told you to pray. It becomes a part of your being and your existence. And don't formalize prayer to be more than it is what it is not. Prayer is talking with the Lord. Now, if you got to turn onto a pillow and talk to the Lord, go ahead, talk to him. Now, I have to get up. And then I bow down to him. It's not like I can't talk to him laying on the pillow. It's not a religious thing, but I feel a drawing to my knees. Because I'm telling him, I prostrate my heart. It's first in the heart before I ever bend the knee. It's not bend the knee first and then the heart expresses. It's the heart that is first that brings me to my knees. What if we had a praying church? Let me say something else. What if we just had a presence church? Woo! God Almighty! If we had a presence church, it's because individuals walked in the presence of the Lord. And they didn't run from the presence of the Lord. They didn't hide from the presence of God. They didn't have a list of the reasons why I have to get this done. You would take that, listen, wait a minute now, before eggs are scrambled and before bacon is crisping, there's an order in this house. You said, well, that'll bring about change in our house. And then crazy wouldn't frustrate you. There was this dear woman of God who received a report that, you know, kind of made a little, maybe irritated a little bit. And when I heard about it, I went to my knees. And when I went to my knees, the Holy One said, give her this message, that he was the first person that she should have called. And I'm telling you, and it applies to me, the very first person you need to call is the name of the Lord. Why? Because in his presence is fullness of joy. And at his right hand, treasures forevermore. I'm going to charge you today. Do you know what BibleGateway.com is? How many of you know that? Raise your hand real quick. Okay, write it down then. BibleGateway.com. It's a search engine that's, you may have one already, but it works. It's got all these different translations, but type in, maybe put it in New King James Version. And then put in the word presence. And the instruction, now I'm just not coming up with this. The instruction is that you read everything that Lord had to say about presence. It'll just give you all the scripture. All of them. Now, some of them are talking about leaving the presence of the king, or the presence of Pharaoh. Bypass them. But whenever you see presence of the Lord or the presence of God, read that. And then all of a sudden you say, ooh, that's good. Oh, yeah. Oh, wow. That is good. There was, let me read something to you. You got time? This is my response to a person, then I'm going to give you the backstory. The Lord's reach to, and I named the person's name, through you is loving, passionate, and resolute. I feel your heart as you fight for your friend. Apostolic correction was the order of the day. Lord, give him ears to hear. Nonetheless, the message will continue to speak beyond this moment, to the glory of God. Stay steady, my brother. Our times are troubling. Our hope is strong. You are called for such a time as this. Now, there is a noted minister that followed Jesus strong and is known nationally, internationally, but who got off in his doctrine. And now he's at the point of dying. And so when I found out about it, it caused me great concern. And while I couldn't call the guy because he doesn't know me, I know someone who knows him. So I called him, and then he had told me, or he let me know, that the message that he had delivered to him. And his message was this, that he has to repent, recant this false doctrine, turn to the Lord, and the Lord will inform him. Seek the Lord in the, you know, when a man is in his strength, you can't tell him a whole lot. You know I'm telling you the truth. Yeah, he got a big head, and he got his own mind, he got his own dreams, he got everything, but get him in a moment of weakness. And all of a sudden, potentially, the heart can come open or the heart is hardened. It can go both ways. But nonetheless, instead of this man of God who delivers this message, when most people try to comfort him and say, it's going to be alive, we love you so much, he was strong enough in the Lord to deliver the accurate message that was needed for such a time as this. And it brought some, it had correction in it. And so when the wife got it, she acknowledged, I feel the anointing of God on this letter. And I rejoiced in that because presence was reaching one more time. God is still able to refresh those who are blind, to reset it. And that servant felt the urgency of God to reach out after 20 years of ministering to this man about how wrong he was, but maybe in the final hour. Look at the love of God. Look at the love of God. And still reaching. He's not a play toy. Some judgments are sudden. But then sometimes long suffering is revealed. In the time of refreshing, this awakening of the Spirit of the Lord, where you realize it in your car, in your truck, by yourself, not only that God is with us, I know that, but God is with us, I know this. I was beside Stacy, and she knew I was with her. My presence was there. I grabbed her arm, and she knew my presence was there. The time of refreshing is, you'll know his time, that his presence is there. I am with you. I'm with you. Does anybody hear this? Now, listen. I'm not predicting gloom on you. But we are in troubling times. So that you won't be carried away with noise from the outside, that your heart draws close, that the promise of God is just not known and repeated. The promise of God is realized in your heart, and you depend on Him to bring it to pass in His time. So we can hear Job says, though he slay me, I will trust him. Come on now. That's not patty cake there. Though he slay me, let me just tell you the terms. Though he slay me, I will trust him. So I'm not measuring his effectiveness, the certainty of his promise, based on what I'm seeing in front of me. My heart of faith saying that all that he has promised shall certainly come to pass. And so now, if I talk to you about presence, well, let's just do this one. You'll love this one. Would you turn with me to, let's do Jude 1:24. Yeah. Keep in mind, time of refreshing. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, King James just tell you straight, keep you from falling. That's a stumble. Fall is hitting your face. Now for him, unto him who's able to keep you from falling or stumbling, and to present you how? What? We're talking about you now. Now I'm talking about other people that you know. I'm talking about you. You know you. Now you know he's got to be mighty. To present you faultless. Faultless. Another place says blameless. Now you've heard me teach you this before. Anything that you repent of on this side, anything you change your mind and your heart and your actions on this side, will never be brought up when you stand before his presence. He will not be charging you from what yesterday you did in yesterday. Can I just go ahead and get very serious? He won't be charging you about the aborted baby. He'll just let you see the baby once again. Just give a religious clap. Now to him who's able to keep you from falling, stumbling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. You think we're going to be in heaven sad? If there's ever been a breakout of happy, happy. Come on now. If there's ever been a breakout of selfless happy. Because see, happy can be hindered when self is involved. But when you put self in its place and give God the glory he deserves, the joy of the Spirit of the Lord just gushes like a well, Jesus described, springing up into everlasting life. I'm talking about the experience of God that's not for the elite. It's for those who dare to be weak. You didn't hear that either. Because we're in the goat generation. Who's the greatest of all time? Nobody. It shouldn't be a debate, who's the goat, who's the goat. Jesus is the greatest of all time. And watch this. If I'm daring to be weak, and I know it doesn't sound right, because he said, well, didn't he? Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done. for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I love that song. Until I got mature enough and I didn't have to sing it for me. Because I can say I'm strong, but I want to stay weak. I wouldn't dare want to change weak. You said, Rex, what are you talking about? Say it. I know you want to say it. Say it. Oh, see, y'all don't want to say it. What I'm talking about, that his strength is made perfect in weakness. That when you're just sold out and you recognize in your heart that you could do nothing without him. And on top of that, you wouldn't want to do nothing without him. That's the state of weakness. Because God said Paul wanted the thorn to be removed, which was a demon. The thorn was a demon. It wasn't his eyes were leaking and his body crippled. It was a demon. It was a messenger from Satan with a message. And your enemy is a messenger from Satan with a message that will haunt you and track you. But God wants to heal your mind and give your mind back to you. And so all of a sudden, when I'm sold out and depleted, then am I strong. In weakness, my strength is made perfect in you. My strength is best seen in weakness, in comparison. So now you are not looking to supply your need according to the riches of your glory. God supplies your need according to the riches in his glory. Now you can say, but I'm a worker. I got to get it done. I want you to be a worker. Praise God for you. But you know what? While you're working, be dependent. Don't be self-sufficient. It's amazing that we can start off out the gate on fire for God and come to the very place and do this whole 360 and come back, say, Lord God, I'd rather be weak before you, that your strength would be perfect in me. Amen. That your glory would be manifested in me, that I may please you and serve you and know you, that you and you alone are my exceeding great reward. Not all the things of this life, which is his good pleasure to give you, but nothing is to supersede him being with you, and you know it. Do you not know saints would never sin intentionally if they realize he's with them? Because there's certainly, you won't even steal a steak out of a store with the security guards looking at you. And say, oh no, he's present here. He's present. I'm going to get over that. God free me. Thank you, Jesus. So all of a sudden you have a revival right then. Because the security guy, how many of you, we're going to loosen this up a little bit. How many of you driving down the highway and see a police officer or state patrol and tap your brake? Raise your hand and be honest with the Spirit of God. Whether you're speeding or not, because the presence of the law is there and you tap your brakes. Just in case y'all know I'm telling you the truth, that you've got an instinct in you automatically because you don't want a ticket. So in the presence of grace, in the presence of God, you don't have to tap your brake. Am I right? What I'm saying to you, and believe me, I tap my brake too, and I wasn't just trying to tap it. I just tap it, and because you want to do right, or if I was speeding, which I'm not a speeder, but just in case. just in case that 3 miles over an officer has got a problem today. He has some issues at home, and he mad. Do you not know a patrolman can be mad? We better not put patrolmen and policemen up on a pedestal like they are faultless. Absolutely not. They may have to deal with Adam. They might still be Adam's seed. Yeah, so Adam's seed with a gun, think about it. Like all of a sudden, the uniform makes them spiritual. So that's why you pray for them. The Bible says do it. Pray for authorities. You pray for them. Say amen to that. Amen. And nobody's going to indict you for tapping the brake. But just laugh the next time you do it. You're going to remember this message the next time you just about automatically. So that when temptation comes, you automatically just... See? What if David, when temptation came and he was looking off his balcony and he should have been at war, but now he's walking on his balcony, he sees Bathsheba, and all of a sudden now, he should have rushed into his bedroom, his boudoir, or whatever he called it, and fell on his knees and lifted his hands and said, "Oh Lord, I'm about to mess up. Help me, Jesus." That's the formula. Help me. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he'll run from you. Amen? Isn't that right? Amen. All right, so did I get to my scripture? Yes, Jude 1:24? Yeah. All right, so final scripture, Psalms 16 and 11. You will show me the path of life in your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. In his presence is fullness of joy. In his presence may not be fullness of happy in the moment, but joy in the moment is always available. Jesus said, "My joy I leave with you." I'm going to do that. Mine. So that you can master every situation. As we bring this to a conclusion, and we're going to pray for the children just like I told you we would, because it was God's order to do that. The time of refreshing, say it with me. And it's from the Lord. What do I need to do? First order of business is to obey anything the Holy Spirit has checked you on. I don't have to make up something. Anything the Spirit of God has checked you on. Or if you can answer this question and say, "Well, how are you doing in the Lord?" And you say, "Well, you know, well," whatever that "well" is attached to, correct it. All right? Show God that you're serious. And remember, last week you got to prime the pump. So since you got to prime the pump to get what's down in the earth, so thanksgiving for what you already have. Do you know what it means to thank God for your spouse, thank God for your children, thank God for your job, and not because you expect, "I suppose to have a job." No. You don't suppose. It's the goodness of the Lord that's providing for us. And so with this, we give God thanks. So the Bible says, in all things, give thanks. Not for all things, in all situations, give God thanks because God is good. Amen? Amen? All right. So it begins with a prayer life. And then you become addicted to prayer. You know, anything you do more than one or two, three times, you become addicted to it. And also, let's talk about fasting. I know somebody, I saw your brain. I saw it. You're saying, "Pastor, let's talk about dying." Well, yeah. Dying to self. So fasting, let's start on Monday. And then Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday. And before you think I'm crazy, Friday. But who will say we're going to join? Some of you say, well, Monday is my day. Raise your hand. Real high. That's because it was about right here. Yeah, Tuesday is my day. Okay? Wednesday? Wednesday's her day. Thursday. You got Thursday? You coming to church on Thursday. Sister, anybody raise their hand other than Thursday? Anybody else had Thursday? So just like Daniel praying for a whole nation, you got the whole church covered. Amen? Friday? Any Friday people? Anybody turn me off, tune me out, turn your ear, hearing aid down? Are you saying, Pastor, I can't fast? You fast at night. That's why they call it break fast. Breakfast. Because you broke it. I didn't tell you how long. The Spirit of God will help you with that. It's just a commitment in your heart that I'm going to set aside the plate and I'm going to seek God. Amen? Everybody follow that? The baby was praising the Lord. Yeah. So did we get Friday in? Everybody get Friday? Anybody got any Saturday fasters? Okay. What's the objective? What's God? Now, I didn't just make this up. You know, this is when I was in the chamber, he gave me instructions, and I thank God that you're people that will listen. When you say, what does it take? What do we need to do for this time to be prepared? Are people prepared for the coming of the Lord? Prepared for the coming of the Lord. In my heart, prepared for the coming of the Lord. So there comes discipline. Amen? Fasting is not just not eating. It's a spiritual discipline that empowers you with clarity for the visitation of God in your life. And so you crucify the flesh, yes. And you said, but I've never fasted before. It's a good time to start because we're doing it together. The end game is that we become a consistent, willingly, without having to announce it and get a T-shirt, a praying church. Because just as the days are of refreshing are upon us, the counter to us will be very evident. Because evil is abounding, but you're called to stay steady with the Lord. Amen? Now you may say, well, what is fasting? What do we do? Well, don't eat. How about if I make it clear? Somebody said, well, can you drink water? Water's not food. Of course, stay hydrated. But you know, sometimes you go on 6-7 hours and say, I haven't eaten anything all day. How many people have said it before? Just turn it to a spiritual discipline, and all of a sudden, all the demons and creepy crawlers will bring you ice cream sandwiches, Nutty Buddies, Snickers. You just didn't even want no spaghetti, hadn't desired it, but just a thought of spaghetti with mozzarella dripping down inside the noodles. All of a sudden, that's just ever before you. That's when you know God is with you. And the enemy is against you. Because he doesn't want God to get the glory for what will be revealed in us. What will be revealed in us. And how many of you know that we need things revealed in us? I reckon that the suffering of this present time is not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. And we think that, oh, that's going to be heaven. No, that's tomorrow. Because just like that brother sent that man that letter, he didn't want him in hell. He said, well, do you have a more amplified New Living Translation for that? Yeah. He didn't want him in hell. There's a difference between saved and unsaved. It is. And it's not of our works. It's the work Christ did for us to believe. Amen? So right now, we're going to pause, and we're just going to get things straight. Okay? In your heart, because remember, we're going to do communion, and when you take communion, you got to have everything straight in your heart. And I can't read your heart. It's between you and the Lord. But you want everything set in order. If you came to church mad, repent so that in the times of refreshing, because it's available, it's coming, the time of refreshing. How many of you in here, you know that in your spirit that you got a message of witnessing Christ and telling everybody about Jesus? Just everybody about Jesus. Y'all not going to raise your hand on that one. That you know. Thank you for some of the hands. That you know that's what's in your heart, that you want to tell people about Jesus. Amen. Okay. Father, in the name of Jesus, unshackle and release these servants to do according to the call that is on their life. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. See, the baby's testifying to the truth. So the babies are in here to help me today. Yeah, you thought the crying was bothering me. It did not. That's the sound of life. Amen? Amen. All right. So what I want you to do, I want you to stand with me if you would. Now that everything is cleared up and you have nothing in your heart, that you've got everything forgiven and under the blood of Jesus, that you've said it personally in your own heart. You've got all of this reconciled. Now you have the privilege to remember the Lord with this sacrament as you open your cup and take your bread. And the night that he was betrayed, the Lord took bread and he said, "This bread represents my body that is broken for you. Eat all of it." I'm going to master this cup. I went to college. And likewise, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the New Testament, new covenant in my blood. It's ratified by the shedding of my blood." And I'm telling you ahead of time the thing that I'm about to do. But as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Amen?
Amen.
Drink all of it. The Lord Jesus bless you. God Almighty keep you. The Lord cause his words be brought back to your remembrance. And the Spirit of the Lord remind you that the time of refreshing is upon us. In Jesus' name, amen.